Welcome back to Psychedelics Today. This is Joe with Kyle here. And today on the show, we have Emanuel Sferios, the founder of Dance Safe. He's also working on a movie called MDMA, The Movie. It's going to be a really cool documentary. I think, did he say a timeline, Kyle?
I don't think so. He's still raising money to finish it up. But I don't know. I thought it was like kind of done because I know they screen it a bunch. But yeah, they're still raising money for like, you know, extra production costs and whatnot.
Right. It sounds like they're doing some fundraising right now so they can finish it up. I hope that they're able to, I think Emanuel said they're going to try to get it into some film festivals next year, and that should be really cool. But yeah, a fantastic guest. He's brilliant, super well-educated on harm reduction, and he came into the subject in a really interesting way that we get into in the show. Was there anything that really surprised you or excited you about the conversation?
I think one thing that stuck out was the history of Dance Safe and like how he came about founding the company and putting it together. And also, I thought it was really interesting that they were doing pill testing early on.
Yeah, well, I think the technology has always been there, right? Like police have to use a similar method. You'll see it on TV shows like Special Victim Unit or whatever. They'll throw the drug in a bag and smash a little vial inside the bag, and it does the reaction inside a bag. So they've been, you know, this tech has been around for a while, which is cool.
Yeah, I guess I didn't really mean the tech, just the fact that MDMA became illegal probably like, what, 10 years before he founded the company. So I figure with the drug war and stuff, it'd be really hard to do that at, you know, music festivals or raves or whatnot.
Yeah, and he was smart enough to team up with lawyers and figure out a game plan and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, it's just really neat. There's a lot of really cool things he raised there. And I hope this is an inspiration for folks out there to take action and figure out what the legal limits are and figure out what risks you're willing to take in the name of harm reduction and the psychedelic movement or drug movement in general.
What was a highlight for you?
I also really like the early days. I really dig the Oprah story, because that's something that kind of personally got me more interested in drugs than I really expected to be back when that hit, like 99, 2000, 2001. That was big news. I don't know if people can really, like Emanuel gets into in the show, it's hard to even imagine how not diverse opinions were back then in the mainstream media, and that a few outlets could really steer the conversation in certain directions. And I think that was, you know, a big one for me. And interesting that Joe Biden had a hand in the RAVE Act. Let us not forget that some of our Democratic Party leaders are still a problem. They are not saints in this drug war harm reduction work. And we need to work to educate everybody, including them, what the right path is forward. Cool. So I guess that's enough for the intro here. We're going to do some ads and hope you enjoy the show. Let us know what you think. Psychedelics Today email at gmail.com or psychedelicstoday.com/contact. Take care. Kyle and I decided to run another book giveaway contest. We're giving away a ton of stuff here, and all you have to do is give us your email. You can sign up over at psychedelicstoday.com. It's called the Ultimate Psychedelic Book Giveaway. Probably close to $350 worth of stuff. Let me read off the list of stuff you can get here. Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, Dennis McKenna. LSD, My Problem Child, Reflections on Sacred Drugs, Mysticism, and Science by Albert Hoffman. The Psychedelic Explorer's Guide by Fadiman. P-Call, A Chemical Love Story by the Shulgins. Dirty Pictures about Sasha Shulgin. LSD, Doorway to the Numinous by Groff. Adventures of Self-Discovery by Groff. Healing Our Deepest Wounds. The Ultimate Journey, When the Impossible Happens. And Holotropic Breathwork, all by Groff. And that last one was co-written with his late wife, Christina. And you get a seat in our class, Navigating Psychedelics, Lessons on Self-Care and Integration. More on that soon. You also get a Psychedelics Today t-shirt and mug. Yeah, we're roughly guessing this is about $350 worth of stuff. If you want to sign up, check us out, psychedelicstoday.com, and you'll see the link for a giveaway. You'll see my face with holding some books. You just click that and you get there. The more you share, the more you increase your odds of winning. Some folks have shared it all over Reddit, YouTube, various forums they're in, and it really has increased their odds of winning. So you just will email you a link after you sign up. You share that. The more people that sign up through your link, the more chances you get to win. The contest ends January 1, so make sure to get your entries into the contest before then. Best of luck. Kyle and I decided to raise some funds using Patreon, which is a really cool way to support the show because you can choose to donate a small portion of money monthly for certain prizes. We are allowing you guys access to interviews before they will ever hit the web. So, for instance, this Horizons episode, they've had that for a few days. And I believe there's some panel discussion stuff we've recorded and made available there. You'll probably also have access to some member or patron-only webinars. We also have rewards including t-shirts, stickers, mugs, access to our Navigating Psychedelics class, and much more. So check it out, patreon.com/psychedelicstoday, or you can get a link from our site, psychedelicstoday.com. Welcome back to Psychedelics Today. We have on the show the founder of Dance Safe, Emanuel Sferios. Thanks for joining us, Emanuel.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Thanks. So we have you on the show to chat a little bit about history and some current projects. So I guess first, let's maybe start, like, why did you choose to organize something like Dance Safe?
Wow. Well, that's a big question. I guess it really goes back to having taken MDMA when I was 16 years old. In 1986, 1 year after it was made illegal, I was a teenage runaway living in a warehouse, and some adults recommended to me that I do therapy. But of course, you know, as a homeless kid, I couldn't afford therapy. But then I read the first ever article in a mainstream news magazine on MDMA. It was the April 1985 Newsweek article, and it was all about its use in therapy. It was still legal at the time. The article said hearings were coming up because the DEA had proposed banning it. And there was one paragraph about some, you know, people in Texas using it recreationally, but really it was all about, up until that point, it was pretty much therapeutic medicine. And so I just decided as a teenager I was going to seek out this drug and take it. I did it with my best friend, talked about my childhood trauma, and it was extraordinarily profoundly healing for me, really changed my life, allowed me to develop a relationship with my father again. I never moved back in, but so, you know, probably did it a dozen times, a couple of years, and then forgot all about it until I'm living in the San Francisco Bay Area, seminary and graduate school, and a friend of mine gives me some MDMA. I said, wow, yeah, I haven't done this in over a decade. Let me get online and see, you know, what we know about it now. Because when I first did it, there wasn't an internet. I went to the library, you know, there's hardly any articles at all about it. And that's when I discovered the market was highly adulterated and people were dying from fake ecstasy tablets, particularly paramethoxyamphetamine, PMA, which still keeps cropping up and there's a wave of deaths whenever it appears. And the Dutch government was funding a program where they were setting up booths at raves and with a chemical reagent testing pills for people to help them avoid the counterfeit pills. And I just said, wow, that's great. I'm going to do that over here. It's just a way to expand harm reduction to another community. I'd been a needle exchange volunteer. I kind of got into drug policy reform, had been into it through the racial justice angle. I'd been working with a prison rights group and downtown Oakland, and it was mostly we worked with families, African-American families who had male relatives in prison for life or a handful of rocks. So, like, you know, that got me into needle exchange, you know, the alternative to the drug war, you know, harm reduction. And since I had organizing skills, despite having never been to a rave that was in my community at all, I decided I was going to start it. And I like to say, too, I feel very privileged to become a part of that community because really the volunteers made the organization what it was. Like, people really wanted to help each other, take care of each other. There's a great spirit in the rave culture, which very well may have to do with it being sort of fueled by MDMA rather than, say, alcohol.
What was it like getting Dance Safe started? Was there any, like, pushback? Because, you know, now I guess at festivals, the Rave Act is kind of like a thing and people worry about providing harm reduction. Was there any type of like worry when you were getting this, you know, started up?
Yeah, well, that's very interesting, you know, because I thought there would be more than there was, more pushback than there was. I am fully expected to get arrested and defend myself in court in the same way needle exchange programs did. I hired a needle exchange attorney in the Bay Area, and we had a strategy and a plan underway. All of our volunteers around the country were, you know, briefed on the plan. They knew that if they got arrested, we would come out and support them. And it never happened. We actually worked out amnesty agreements with local police in multiple cities not to arrest users approaching the booth to have their pills tested. It was like a little brief window of how things should be. And we were succeeding fairly well cleaning up the market. But then the federal government got in the way, which I think is typically the pattern. You know, with cannabis legalization today, states want to do it, the feds don't. Of course, now, you know, with Trump and Sessions in there, the clock's being turned back a little bit, though I don't think they're going to be able to rejuvenate the drug war as much as they want, because culture changes faster than they think. But in any case, yeah, the feds sort of came down on us, you know, the whole rave culture in general, right? They, speaking of the Rave Act, very important piece of legislation to know about. It's really primarily what's responsible for the increase in fatalities around the country related to MDMA. Promoters no longer want to work with DanceSafe or implement harm reduction measures or have drug education on site, because this federal law threatens to prosecute promoters or venue owners if they do anything besides take a zero tolerance approach. The RAVE Act was passed in 2003, by the way. It was authored by Joe Biden. It's actually called the Illicit Drug Anti-Proliferation Act, because in 2002 they tried to pass it as the RAVE Act, standing for Reducing Americans' Vulnerability to Ecstasy Act.
Huh, interesting.
Yeah, and it was so anti-music culture, even the name of it said, we're going after these countercultural music events, right? So the name reflected that they're going after a specific culture, and they even had provisions in the original act in 2002 that said, you know, like, you could recognize a rave by the number of beats per minute of the music, and by glow sticks, and things like that. And of course, like, Congress did not pass it. They're like, you know, this is crazy. This has got nothing to do with drugs, right? But, you know, the DEA, you know, they just thought that the music was just an excuse for, you know, having drug parties, and that the music was only designed to enhance the effects of illegal drugs. That's what they thought, you know. But so there was a backlash, and they failed. They didn't pass. And then so they changed the name the next year. They removed all of the provisions to kind of disguise who it was they were really going after, renamed it, and then they tacked it on to the Amber Alert legislation, which, if you know anything about Washington, it's really hard, you're a congressperson, to vote against some child safety law, right? So That's how they kind of snuck it in 2003, and then they immediately started cracking down on raves. And the thing about it is that it's an expansion of the crack house laws, right? The language says if you maintain a drug-involved place or premises, then you can be liable. Well, but, you know, what does that mean? It's extremely ambiguous, and I think the ambiguity was intentional because, you know, if they made it specific, like if you're dealing drugs, like if you were a promoter and you're actually breaking the law, right, dealing drugs or somehow facilitating the sale of drugs in your club, et cetera, That could be easily determined by a jury or a judge. But by making it ambiguous, maintaining a drug-involved premises, the attorneys and insurance reps of the promoters said, wow, we don't know what that means. This could go any way. You better just shut down, right? And the DEA used it as a threat, as leverage to basically force promoters to shut down or else risk getting prosecuted, and who knows which way it would go because the law is so ambiguous. And then that's sort of where we are today. You know, there was a hiatus or kind of in the mid-noughts, a period where there weren't a lot of raves or EDM festivals, and there's not big ones. And now 2010-11, it kind of took off into the mainstream, where now we have these billion-dollar corporations putting on multi-day EDM festivals, and we have this antiquated law out there that's preventing them from implementing harm reduction.
So backtrack a little bit. You said you were like originally testing pills when you first started?
Yeah, right. Exactly. You know, when I first started Dance Safe, the concept really was only ecstasy pill testing. I started the laboratory program also, the one that's now hosted at ecstasydata.org. That was originally at Dance Safe. And so the lab testing, and we sold the testing kits through the website and started going out to events testing pills. It was only after I attracted volunteers and kind of got familiar with the community that it expanded into a peer-based drug education program as well, where we, you know, in a sense, we're trying to create a responsible drug culture where people considered their health and safety and sort of ratcheted down the whole rebellious side of drugs that I think is a product of prohibition and just say no. That sort of came about later, but originally it was just about pill testing.
That's fascinating. And I didn't know that. That's really cool that you were able to do that back then.
It was like, you know, I remember the first time two police approached the booth. And this is at the Home Base Warehouse in downtown Oakland. It's since burnt down, but it was called the International Rave Center, right? This, at that point, time, late 90s, there's probably like 5,000 to 10,000 people there, and they were called masses, right? The biggest raves, masses. So it's like a noun, the name. Going to the massive tomorrow night, blah, blah, blah. And they had a big fenced-in outdoor area, parking lot area, where all the vendors were, and that's where we set up. And, man, we would test 1,000 pills in a night. Starting about 9 p.m., the line would form. We had two testing stations. We couldn't see the end of the line. Our voices would get hoarse, wow, repeating, this is a positive test. It's like Amsterdam or Portugal today. Like, it was like that. It was, and here come the first time, these cops, they're in uniform, they're off duty, but they're hired as security. I'm like, okay, what do I do now? And as soon as they're checking out the vendors, and I was like, they're going to see us. And so I step in front of the booth, and I say, hi, officers. My name's Emanuel Sferios. We're here testing ecstasy tablets, because you know those dealers will sell these kids anything, blah, blah, blah. I drop, name drop the health department, and, you know, who, of course, I did network with. And then I just stopped and stared them right in the eye, and the next thing they said was, well, thank you very much. I appreciate what you're doing. And I got their names, and they would hang out with us. And at one point, like a couple of events later, I remember having to say, hey, can we go over there and talk? Because your presence right by the testing booth is kind of scaring some of the young people. And, oh, sorry, sorry. And we walked away to chat. You know, it was like, it was really, they were safety officers like they were supposed to be. Then, slowly, so then in 1999, pressure, the DEA launches their big campaign. They start trying to prosecute promoters under the crack house laws. This is before the RAVE Act, and they fail. Disco Donnie in New Orleans was one of their test cases. He's a founder of SFX, which I think is still around today, one of the big rave promoters, but he almost went to prison. They went, you know, they bankrupted him and shut him down, but they lost. And it was their failure to prosecute promoters under these crack house laws that led them to write a new law called the RAVE Act. Mm-hmm. And Biden's role in that's very interesting, too. Not sure if you want me to talk about it, but, you know, his daughter was a regular at Disco Don's Club in New Orleans. And many people think that's why he was willing to write this, because according to the Village Voice at the time, she also had a drug problem. And like we do in our culture, and many families, fathers in particular, much easier to blame the drug, blame people dealing drug, blame the culture in which your child is taking the drug, rather than dealing with the hard issues that come along with addiction that often involve your family life. And so
right,
he does seem very sincere when you go back and look at his testimony to Congress and how he didn't want the RAVE Act used to prosecute legitimate promoters, but the DEA did that anyway.
So you said it was Biden's daughter?
Yes.
Oh, that's fascinating. Now, let's get into the kind of Oprah story, because this actually impacted me. I got a really awkward phone call one night from my mother. It's like my first year at college, getting grilled about drinking too much water. It's like, holy shit. Like, I had not done a drug at that point in my life, so it's kind of like scary and comical at the same time. She's like,
drinking
the watch
too much
signs.
Water?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. My mother was concerned about my water consumption, thinking I was doing ecstasy.
Well, you know, that's actually very smart of her, because one of the risks is hyponatremia, because MDMA causes water retention, believe it or not. It's one of the ironic things a lot of people don't realize. You know, the biggest risk is overheating. Serotonergic drugs increase the risk of heat stroke, including Prozac and Zoloft and other antidepressants. And that's really what's going on with MDMA-related fatalities. They're really heat stroke deaths where the environment and the behavior are more important than the drug, but the drug can increase that risk. So this is why free water, children's, et cetera. But another problem that happens is hyponatremia, or people who drink too much water. And part of that is the harm reduction message was, watch out for heat stroke, make sure you drink water. And sometimes people start to feel like they're overheating, and then they'll drink like a gallon of water, and that can cause problems on its own. But on MDMA, because of the water retention, it can kill you. And this is most likely the main reason that we see 2-to-1 ratio of MDMA fatalities female to male. More, twice as many females die. And that has to do with how estrogen impacts the way sodium crosses cell membranes. So estrogen increases the risks of hyponatremia. But if your mom was concerned about that, she was actually on the right track. You do need to be careful about water intake.
Yeah.
Taking MDMA.
Absolutely. I think my big takeaway,
but
she wasn't wrong.
The Oprah show.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It was specifically because
Oprah
of Oprah.
The Oprah didn't have anything. Oprah has a bunch of propaganda nonsense. That's actually, you know, we were going to go on Oprah. I should go back a bit about, you know, how this, I like to call it the last great government anti-drug propaganda campaign, started in 1999 when the DEA wanted to shut down the rave culture. They sent out press releases to all the mainstream news papers, magazines, TV stations, et cetera, around the country. New demon drug. We need to crack down on it. You know, save the children. You got to remember, too, this is right at the time, just after, you know, Gary Webb's Dark Alliance series came out, and the DEA and CIA involvement in bringing crack cocaine into this country was on, you know, people's minds, and the DEA's status was not like they wanted it to be. So partly this was a way for them to improve their status, create a new demon drug, and sweep in and pretend like you're saving the children. And how it kind of reached into our world is I get a call from 60 Minutes and Dateline on the same day wanting to do stories on DanceSafe. So I'm like, this is weird. What's going on? You know, then I find out, talking to my colleagues, oh, they just got this press release. This is part of a demonization campaign by the DEA. Whoa, should I do it? And, you know, I've actually Rick Doblin, who told me, you should do it anyway. He said, any news about harm reduction is good news. So I decided to go on 60 Minutes, and the talking head just basically asked me 50 different ways, aren't you just promoting drug use? What do you say to parents who say you're just promoting drug use? And I learned in my PR classes, well, people who advised me about public relations, never repeat your opponent's argument, even to deny it, right? So if I had ever said during that interview, no, we're not promoting drug use, then you know that's all they would have put in the show is me denying it, right? So instead, when she asked me that, I would say, the drug war kills children, harm reduction saves lives. I would just stay on message, you know. But the interesting thing is the producer who was doing the show, she came out, she flew out a few times to see me. Just before I went on the air, she whispers in my ear, you know, I've taken ecstasy. I just want you to know I like what you're doing. And so a couple of weeks later, 60 Minutes is the first, you know, mainstream TV news magazine to break the story. And you got to understand, for your younger listeners, and maybe you guys are millennials too, you might not remember what it was like prior to the internet, or this really, 99, this was just after the internet came out. So you still had a handful of TV news shows that set the entire nation's conversation, right? Like, it's not like today where we have hundreds of different news sources. Like, back then it was a big deal, 60 Minutes, right? And so, like, that's why I call it the last great government anti-drug propaganda campaign, because you can't do it anymore.
Right.
Like, there's just, you can put all this money into it, but it doesn't matter. Cause, like, first of all, the internet's going to laugh at you when you put out holes in your brain live. But so the story came out, and it was 12-minute demon drug, just what you'd expect. But right in the middle, there is this 3 minutes of DanceAce, and it did us justice. It was, you know, objective, and it made us look good. And it created this message that, which was the truth, that not ecstasy is killing people, but fake ecstasy is killing people. And also, because it was the first one, it opened the door for all the other shows to do the same story on DanceAce. And my phone never stopped ringing. I was on MTV, CNN, 48 Hours, Geraldo, the Jim Lehrer Hour, on and on and on, Playboy, Time, Newsweek, Cosmo. And essentially, we hijacked the DEA's anti-ecstasy campaign, and it became all about harm reduction. Rained on their parade big time.
Nice job.
And there was this, well, that was accidental. I was just doing my thing. You know?
Yeah.
But I liked the irony that DanceAce probably would never have gotten so big if the DEA hadn't have launched this campaign never ceases to make me laugh. You know, like, I owe DanceAce owes its existence today to the DEA, I think, because that's when I raised $500,000. That's when all the dot-comers found out about us and said, hey, you like what you're doing, and gave us money, and we were able to expand dramatically. Yeah, so then it changed, right? Then they intervened, and the Oprah show was one of them, right? We were all set to go on Oprah. Rick Goblin, myself, Sue Stevens, who was one of the first advocates who used MDMA with her late husband who had cancer before he died, and she was on Ecstasy Rising. They were going to do the good MDMA show, and then a couple weeks before we were all set to go on, they call us up and say, sorry, we've decided to go a different direction. And we're like, okay. And then the show came out, and it was the most ridiculous. They had this girl on, and her doctor, and the radiologist, who showed this brain scan where they turned up the contrast so that areas of low blood flow looked like they were empty, like holes, and told her, you've got holes in your brain. And you look at and they showed this rotating blue brain that literally half the brain is missing. And told her, these are holes, you know, golf ball size holes in your brain. The most ludicrous thing you can imagine. You know, I've actually found similar anti-drug nonsense online. We're going to sort of highlight this in the movie. You know, this is a classic tactic where you just try to scare young people into thinking, I mean, it's for cannabis, for all these other drugs. They, you know, whatever you do, whether if you're reading a book versus meditating versus exercise, the blood flow in your brain is going to be slightly different. And you can measure blood flow, task-based blood flow, using these PET scans, and then you could turn up the contrast in Photoshop and make it look like there's holes in your brain. And they've done that, and there's images all over the internet. You know, this is what happens when you smoke pot, right? You get these giant holes in your brain. But anyway, like, so this woman, Lynn Smith, she was 17 years old at the time. I was outraged. Like, how could they be telling her this? And her mom. So I looked her up and I called her on the phone and just to say, you know, you really don't have holes in your brain. I just, you know, want you to know that. Like, maybe you were using too much MDMA, but you did not cause holes in your brain. And she says, oh, I know that, but I'm having a good time being on TV.
Oh, my God.
I was like, okay, I mean, what do you say to a teenager who's, you know, like, fine. So now I'm making this documentary, right? And about 6 months ago, I'm thinking, yeah, it'd be great to, like, interview her. Let's see what, you know, she... you've learned in hindsight, maybe she's got some wisdom now, realizes that they exploited her, etc. And I find out she's actually a higher up in the Partnership for a Drug-Free America, and she wrote a book, which is, she still has her website, called Rolling Away, My Agony with Ecstasy. So essentially she made a career out of this nonsense idea that MDMA put holes in her brain. And she, I decided to, you know, contact her anyway. I left her a couple messages. She never responded to me. Kind of a funny story. But it's still around. You know, the one thing, you know, people who don't know, the one thing they're going to tell you is, oh, that drug put holes in your brain. It's that kind of propaganda.
Right. And wasn't there some science that they were using methamphetamines too with some of those brain scans?
Yeah.
Like it was mislabeled and...
Yeah, well, ostensibly it was mislabeled and not intentional, but there's some question about that. One has to wonder. That was George Riccardi, probably NIDA's pet anti-drug neuroscientist, who induced Parkinson's disease in rats by giving them extremely large intravenous doses of methamphetamine, which we know can result in that, damages dopamine neurons. But then he claimed it was a result of MDMA. The most suspicious thing at the time is that everyone then, all the neuroscientists who were doing research at the time, knew that MDMA didn't impact dopamine neurons. Serotonin neurons, yes, but not dopamine neurons. And so, like, even the medical journal that this was published in, like, one has to wonder, like, they didn't question it, you know, but if anyone had questioned it at any point along the way, they could have traced it back and realized, oh, this, there was a mistake, you know. But it got out, and it became a big media issue right at the time that all this anti-rave campaign was going on. But eventually he retracted it. I think it was an intern who outed him, who said, wait a minute, this wasn't MDMA.
I think you're right. I remember that. Did Oprah ever backtrack at all? Like, I know recently she's published some pro-MDMA articles, but did she, like, back in the 90s or early aughts?
No, I don't think she's ever backtracked on the holes in your brain. I'm going to try to, you know, get a hold of the radiologist. Someone has got to. And if not, I'll just, you know, in the movie, we're just going to explain what was really going on. It's kind of funny, and I think for young people, they're really going to enjoy seeing it, too, because really, it's not, like, you had some media hysteria around Flocka happening recently, you know, like the zombie face eater in Miami, who turns out he wasn't on any drugs at all, he just had an illness, you know, but when that video came out, they said, oh, it was from Flocka, you know, so there's a little bit of drug hysteria that still happens kind of randomly, usually by local news stations and stuff like that. But we never really had a coordinated disinfo campaign, propaganda campaign, like, you know, Reefer Madness style, since this anti-ecstasy campaign. So I think young people aren't used to seeing that and to know that that was actually good. Their own government was intentionally putting out lies, like ridiculous nonsense lies that could never fly today. I think this would be a very entertaining section of the movie.
Right. Now all the science is starting to come out. So, yeah, it's hard to really, make some crazy stuff up. But I'm curious to know, do you know, like, anything about the safety profile of MDMA? Like, how safe is it? Or, you know, I know that regulating temperature can be a thing. But, like, I've always heard, like, neurotoxicity, like, is a thing with MDMA, taking high doses. And...
Yeah, so that's how I was going to clarify all this, right? There's all this propaganda out there, but nonetheless, there's ample evidence that in high doses that most likely overlap what some human users are doing is neurotoxic. That's been shown in animal studies. You can't tell for sure in human studies because you actually have to cut the brain open.
Right.
And look at it to really know. There's kind of certain markers that could be checked by using radioactive ligands and seeing how much serotonin is reuptake and making a guess, but those aren't quite as conclusive. I've researched this as a harm reduction activist probably more extensively than anyone, including speaking to all the researchers involved, getting them on the phone to debate one another. And my conclusion, and this was even from back in 2000, but I still have it today, is that, there are some human users sustaining neurotoxic damage, but there's no evidence it produces any cognitive impairments. The studies that show minor differences between heavy MDMA users and control groups are flawed, all of them, in numerous, very significant ways. First is they never require the heavy users to have abstained for very long. because it's impossible to find people who have abstained, say, for a year or more to be in your study. Because if what they'll do is they'll put out word through the internet. And who discovers this? Current ecstasy users discover, oh, there's a study I can go in. And then they call it, hey, can I join your study? And they say, when's the last time you used? And oh, you know, last week. You know, so they require 2 weeks. Most of these studies require only 2 weeks of abstinence. And then they compare. They take all these people that join this study, and you have to trust them that they haven't used in 2 weeks, but they're weekly users, you know, poly drug users even. And then you give them some cognitive ability tests and compare them to a control group, which is typically grad students at the university where you're doing the study, who are in a very studious mode. And, of course, you're going to see minor differences, and that's all they've ever seen, minor differences in verbal memory, et cetera. There is absolutely no, this does not provide any evidence that those minor differences are a result of neurotoxicity. Most likely, they are a result of temporary brain chemical and receptor downregulation, all these things we know happens when you're in a polydrug abusing lifestyle. So I like to say, yes, we know MDMA is neurotoxic, and most likely if you take MDMA every week or you take high doses, you may be approaching that level where you're sustaining some neurotoxic damage. But until they find any cognitive impairments, until we see people who are seeking treatment or even claiming that they are permanently, you know, there's just none of that going on. MDMA has been around 40 years now, illegal for 30 years, where people were doing clearly massive doses. We don't have a generation of lost youth. Mm-hmm. We don't have the problems that the DEA claimed we would, which led to its banning back in 1985. They're just not there. So, and I also like to say, you know, there is a drug that's highly neurotoxic that produces extreme cognitive impairments if you use it too much, and permanent. And that drug is legal and sold in every street corner. It's called alcohol. So the neurotoxicity of a drug really shouldn't determine our public policy surrounding it alone, right? It should be a balance of harms and benefits and the demand for it, right? There's high demand for MDMA. It's not going to go away. We can reduce the harms and risks just by decriminalizing it and other drugs, right? But legal regulation, where we strictly regulate it so adults can have safe legal access, would actually shrink the criminal markets, making MDMA less available to minors. And I think everyone would agree with that, right? Cognitive liberty for adults, but we don't want most drugs being sold on corner stores. Legalization is not this, like, libertarian buyer beware. It's legal regulation. And every drug needs to be regulated differently. There's different models. So I think it's time we start talking about how to do it, because we know prohibition is not regulation at all. It just creates a thriving criminal market.
Yeah, and also other dangerous drugs, right?
Yeah.
Variants, right. And being in the scene for a while, and have you noticed like an increase in like different chemicals over the years doing like drug testing with the ecstasy data?
No, it's absolutely insane. The increase in chemicals is almost exponential. I think there's over 100 a year that different labs around the world are discovering now. They're called research chemicals when you buy them, because they're, to get around analog laws, they have to be sold as not for human consumption. But it's a wink and a nod. Everyone knows that they're psychoactive drugs. We have the cathinones now, also called bath salts, MDPV, methylone, butylone, alpha PVP, you know, hundreds of them. We have the N-bomb series. 25i N-bomb is a big killer, masquerading as LSD. There are hundreds of new drugs now. And the reason that they're out there is because two reasons. The information on how to make it is now widely available on the internet. So if you're a chemist or you have basic chemistry skills and you want to make some of these drugs, you can easily learn how to do it. But number two, with the darknet and Bitcoin, cryptocurrencies and the Tor network, essentially anonymous commerce, means you can now buy and sell drugs virtually risk-free. this is going to be a section in our film too. This is not the best solution, right? It has certainly pointed out the futility of prohibition. If anyone thought we could win the drug war just by putting more money into it before the darknet, I think everyone's got to wake up and realize that ain't happening now, because a 13-year-old could use their parents' credit card and buy a bunch of cocaine and have it delivered to their friend's house now on the darknet. But, you know, but it's not so much buying it. Everyone, you know, there's been a lot of journalistic exposés about how you can buy drugs online right now. The really important piece of this puzzle is that now you can sell drugs online,
right,
virtually risk-free. That's why there's all these new drugs appearing everywhere. And, you know, because the price point for MDMA is so high, it's in high demand, but the cost of some of these bath salts, like methylene, for example, is so low, you can buy a kilo of methylene, cap it up, and sell it as Molly to unsuspecting young people and make a way more money than you would if you bought real MDMA on the darknet. So as long as the classic psychedelics, LSD, you know, mushrooms, MDMA, say throw 2CB in there, that's a good one, it's got a track record, it's pretty safe, you know, as long as those remain illegal, and cannabis is a perfect example of that, then all of the fake knockoffs, all the synthetic cannabinoids now that are killing people left and right, they're going to proliferate. But when you if you were to legalize cannabis, who would buy these dangerous synthetic cannabinoids? Nobody would do it. You would eliminate the market. People want the classic psycho. You know, there'll always be some psychonauts that want to experiment with the new drugs. I've known some of them myself. Heck, I've dabbled in some of the lesser-known psychedelics personally. But the vast majority of young people out there, you know, teenagers and people just trying to park, they want LSD, mushrooms, they want MDMA. They just want to get high. Mm-hmm. Why don't we legalize the classic psychedelics and shut down the RC market by default? Shrinkage. It wouldn't shut down. But
what do you think the percentage of like purity is out there? Like, I just always have friends or people are like, oh yeah, this is like really pure, this or that, and it's like, well, do you really know that? They're like, oh, so and so told me. It's like, well,
like that 84% number.
Yeah. So like, what do you think that like the rate is out there? Right. The percentage of purity.
There's two concepts of purity. One is sort of when it comes out of the lab, say before it gets watered down, say it just comes straight out of the lab, the chemist can do thorough washes and get a high purity end result product. And I've heard the highest a hydrochloric salt of MDMA purity can be before it liquefies is upper 80s or early 90s. So that would be considered the purest you could get, you know, when you go on the dark net. I think the chemists, when they say this is 80-something percent pure, that's what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. But then there's another type of purity, which is like when you buy it, has someone cut it with something else. And there's actually a third kind, which is like sort of market purity, like how much of what's being represented to a retail consumer, like as MDMA, really is MDMA at all, as opposed to something else. So we get three different notions of purity here. And what I can tell you from DanceSafe's testing, because despite the RAVE Act, DanceSafe does do pill testing at some festivals and parties where the promoters allow them to. It's usually a wink and a nod in a tent kind of a thing, and they keep statistics. The purity in the sense of market purity, things that are being sold, has actually gone up a bit. You know, there were some years where less than 50% of what people, when they brought some powder or tablet into the DanceSafe booth to get tested, was actually MDMA. And it's probably over 80% now. It actually tests positive for MDMA. The chemical reagent tests that DanceSafe uses don't detect purity in the sense that there could be something else in it. But at least there's MDMA present now in over 80%. Wow. And I think part of that is people are catching on to the bath salts, right? More people are testing, more people are buying test kits. I actually think, too, China has cracked down. It's harder to buy kilos of methylene from China now. So we're actually, it always is going to fluctuate. It's going to go up and down all the time. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, definitely.
I think sometimes there's misconceptions in the drug testing, harm reduction world about the reagent testing versus mass spec or chromatography, like very different tests. They come up with very different data. I think that's really important for people to know.
Yeah, right. The reagents really are just can detect the presence of certain drugs. Now, you can use multiple reagents and get sort of a better idea. You can increase your level of confidence that it does contain X and it doesn't contain Y, but it always could contain something else with a reagent test, because there are many drugs that don't change color at all, right? And so really you need to use gas chromatography, or the new spectroscopy is what we're hoping eventually the price comes down to consumer models now. Like, you basically you shoot a laser in, and by the spectral lines you can tell instantly what drugs are inside of a powder. But the machines now are still in the five-figure range, you know, $30,000-ish. If you ever get those below $1,000, they could become consumer products. And then that puts reagents out of business, which would be a good thing, because they're far superior to reagents. But
absolutely.
That seems to be a long way off. And then lab, if people want, you know, the ecstasydata.org is now where you can send a sample in. Costs a bit of money, but, you know, usually takes no more than a couple of weeks, and you can put a code number down on your sample and go to the website and look at the results a couple of weeks later, and that'll tell you exactly what's in it.
Do you know where they're located?
It's a lab I contracted with in Sacramento back in 1999. They can't do quantitative testing. It's very interesting that this is a loophole in a DEA program that they started in the 60s, where if you have a DEA license, and a lot of private labs can get licenses from the DEA, and if you do, they allow you to receive and test anonymously mailed drugs. The reason the DEA started this program back in the 60s was to allow parents who would find, say, a tablet or pill underneath their child's bed or wherever, and they wanted to find out what was in it, an avenue to do that. Usually, back then, the lab would advertise, write a code number, send it in anonymously with a money order or cash, and the results will be on an outgoing answering machine. So you'd call the answering machine and get the results. So knowing about this program, I contacted this lab and said, hey, what if they were already offering this to as a service? I said, well, what if instead of putting the results on an answering machine, you gave me the results, and instead of putting a code number, the person wrote DanceSafe. I'll advertise for you. In other words, people will send pills in and will write DanceSafe on it, and you give me and take a picture of the pill while you're at it. And they're like, sure, you know, they were making $100 per pill, why not? And that's kind of how the lab program got started. I bought and sent the first six pills in myself, and I remember I didn't really buy ecstasy tablets, you know, I just started DanceSafe, you know, and so I took this risk and I bought six different pills, you know, because they were all pressed tablets back then, you know, like pink Teletubbies or whatever. And they were all pure MDMA. And I was like, oh, damn it, you know, because I was trying to convince people that the market was adulterated. People were sending emails like they were saying, who are you kidding? You want me to send you a pill and $100? Yeah, right, cop. These are the emails I was getting, right? They didn't trust it was real. And so finally someone sent in a DXM tablet, and slowly people started sending pills in. And then Bob Wallace, the ninth employee at Microsoft, he's now deceased, but he was psychonaut, very strong supporter of ours. He stepped in and said, I'll fund the whole program. So Bob Wallace gave us over $200,000 back in the day, and the lab testing program became free. And that's when our servers crashed, because essentially we were testing so many pills from all across the country that the DanceSafe site became the go-to site every weekend when kids would go out to their party, wherever. They would first check the DanceSafe site to see what pills in their area contained, right? Because we'd show a picture of the pill and we'd show the city where it was purchased. And I remember this was like the early days of the internet, and our servers got overloaded and we were crashing. We had to upgrade the server that we were using. We were, you know, getting 200,000 visitors a weekend, and something outrageous for back then. And then when I resigned, I gave the program over to Earth and Fire from Arrowhead to manage it. And it's been hosted at ecstasydata.org now for like the last 17 years.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I really appreciate that story. And there's a lot of context you've been able to give us. I guess let's talk about today. You're working on a film right now called MDMA the Movie, right?
Yes, that's the working title. Probably will end up being the final title of the film because we haven't figured out anything better. And it is going to be a comprehensive look at MDMA, right? But I like to say, really, it's a drug policy reform documentary that pivots around MDMA, but whose main focus is drug war attitudes, drug war culture, particularly around stigma, how we project stigma onto people who use drugs, all drugs, not just psychedelics, and how drug users internalize that stigma and how that affects outcomes, right? We all know as psychedelic users, probably on your podcast here, that, you know, setting and dose, right? Set is your mindset, your intention. What you expect to get out of a drug experience will largely determine, you know, what, how the drug affects you. And so this applies not just to psychedelics, but to all drugs and the concept of addiction. The manifestation of addiction is socially constructed largely based on the cultural attitudes that we have about drugs and how it, and the stigma that we project on them. When you constantly tell someone who's using a drug that they're sick or they're immoral or even that there's no benefits, they're just, it's just a vice, you're just doing that because you have a problem, we as a culture manifest that problematic drug use. And I think bears itself out when you look at one of the recent global drug survey results. Adam Winstock in England runs the largest drug user online survey in the world. 30,000 to 50,000 drug users participate each year. And they asked people, if you know how much MDMA you use, how many milligrams you use in a given session, how much do you use? And they found that the country that had the greatest number of milligrams per session was the UK, averaging about 400 milligrams
Whoa.
Per session.
Average.
Averaging 400 milligrams per session for people who knew. And the country with the lowest was Germany, which averaged 130 milligrams per session. And, you know, what makes, and England was way hot. Like, what makes them stand out? Well, one thing, if you ever, like, go to the Mirror or the Telegraph or just read any UK online journalism, they are the most anti-drug, the most nonsense, ridiculous, propagandist, sensationalist, exaggerated BS that you'll ever read. They still, like, think that cannabis is the demon weed over there, right? And so there's a correlation between how much cultural condemnation there is and judgment and stigma in the culture around drug use with the abusive or misuse of those drugs. I think that is causal. And so when I started DanceSafe, it was largely to say, hey, these drugs have benefits. Why are you, like, taking six pills in a night? You know, don't you realize that you're not going to get the benefits out of them, right? Benefit enhancement and talking about the benefits and how to maximize those is, in fact, a more effective way of getting people to reduce the harms. We know this with child rearing, right? Positive reinforcement is so much more effective than negative reinforcement. If you're out there, like a lot of harm reduction groups are just saying, be careful, you could die, be careful, this could happen, watch out, blah, 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 there's still a way in which that's going to kind of float over people's heads, right? People who are engaged in a behavior, they need to have some kind of positive association with it in order to be responsible. So we were always cutting edge that way, right? And that's how my film's going to push the envelope on that, right? Like, we need to give young people permission to use drugs for their benefits in the same way that we model alcohol intake with our kids, or we should model that. That reduces binge drinking, alcoholism, et cetera. We need to do the same thing with psychedelics and other drugs that have benefits that we use. As long as they remain forbidden fruit, rebellious things, people are going to misuse them.
Right. It's a hard conversation, right? It's so complex. Like, we still see crazy binge drinking with alcohol. I wonder, like, I bet it'll drop the average, but there's still going to be those people, right, with 10 strips and 400 milligrams plus of MDMA.
Yes, you're right.
They're aberrations,
though.
Way
in which, yeah, and there's a way in which some young people need to push those limits. Coming of age, people do it with alcohol. Everyone finds their own limits. Fortunately, if you take too much MDMA one time, you're probably not going to die, and you may learn, whoa, this wasn't, you know, as good as I thought, right? There's an ironic thing about MDMA, probably the most important piece of information to save lives, is that taking more won't get you higher, right? Like with most drugs, you smoke cannabis, you get high, you smoke more cannabis, you get higher. Alcohol, same way. Opiates, same way. Most drugs are that way because they work on postsynaptic receptors directly. They kind of mimic the drugs. But MDMA is a serotonin releaser, and you only have a certain amount of serotonin in your brain, and it takes a week or two to replenish that, depending on diet and genetics, at least a week for everyone. So you can't take MDMA again before that week is up and have the same effect. And you certainly can't keep redosing on MDMA throughout the night. But that's so counterintuitive to a lot of people, especially when the bath salts flooded the market and people thought that that was MDMA. And they got used to taking bumps throughout the night, doing a gram in the night, because you can do that with a drug like methylone, but you think you're taking MDMA. This led to a lot of overdosing, which is correlated with increased risk of heat stroke. And a lot of the fatalities are a result of is people not understanding the dosing, because prohibition is flooding the market with other drugs that have different doses. So that's the most important thing to realize. And I think if as hedonistic as you want to be, you just can't take too much MDMA. It's not, it doesn't sort of allow you to indulge in that kind of behavior. It just won't work if you try to do it.
That's interesting. So, like, if you take a high dose, does that, like, bump the risk up for, say, like a heat stroke or anything like that? Or is that more environmental?
It's more environmental, but it certainly is a part of the equation. It's very complicated, but very important people understand and also know how to speak about it. First thing I like to say is that these are heat stroke deaths. They are not overdose deaths. And the fact is that most people who are dying are not taking abnormally large doses. I don't know if anyone has died after taking 125 milligrams or less. It's very hard to find out, but I've spent a lot of time contacting, speaking with parents and friends of people who have died. Coroners and toxicologists do not do that, by the way. They don't even research the temperature at the environment in which the person died. They will just find MDMA in the bloodstream and say they died from MDMA toxicity and leave it at that. And nobody asks any more questions. And we know that that is incomplete. We now know that in almost all cases, the person was engaged in aerobic activity in an extremely hot environment. And we know that MDMA increases heat stroke risk like other serotonergic drugs do. When a marathon runner dies of heat stroke, and they find out that they were taking Prozac, which likely contributed. They don't say the person died from Prozac toxicity. They say the person died from heat stroke. But when someone dies in a hot rave, similarly engaging in aerobic activity in a hot environment, and they find MDMA in their system, they always call it an overdose of MDMA. And it's false, and it's very dangerous, because what does that do? It sends this message to young people that the person died because they took too much, and as long as you don't take too much, you know, overdose means you took too much. And so as long as you don't take too much, you're going to be fine. But it's not true. These young people, every single one that I've researched, they took a normal dose. There were a few, qualify that, there were a few cases that I've researched where people died in a cool environment after taking a fairly large dose. But there's also pre-existing health conditions and genetic abnormalities that can predispose someone to having an adverse hypothermic reaction to MDMA. It's also a very important point I could touch on in a minute. But so first I'll say, yes, we should call these heat stroke, not overdoses, but dose does matter. You know, the larger dose you take, the greater risk there is in a hot environment to sustain. And of course, if anyone who can die, if you took enough MDMA, and it's different, you know, for every person, but it's a couple grams or more would probably kill a lot of people. So that would be a real overdose. There's very few people have ever died from a straight up overdose of MDMA because nobody takes that much. But if you did, your death would look exactly like a heat stroke death. And then they call that serotonin syndrome. You've probably heard that. Serotonergic drugs can dysregulate body temperature, causing it to spike. PMA does that incredibly at a very low level, which is why it's so dangerous as a counterfeit MDMA. Two PMA tablets can kill a lot of people because it's much more toxic in that way. And they would call that serotonin syndrome. And that could happen even in a cool environment if you took a large enough dose. So there's this curve. Imagine like a dose, aerobic activity, and environmental heat curve, where as each of those things get higher, your risk of having an adverse reaction gets higher. So dose matters, but it's important that we recognize the environmental heat and the behaviors, aerobic activity in particular, are much stronger factors leading to these adverse reactions.
Awesome. Thanks for that. That's really interesting.
Yeah. Well, we're at about an hour. I know you're doing a round of fundraising for your film. Could you kind of point anybody in a direction if they wanted to do some support for your film at all?
Yeah, sure. Anyone there who wants to learn more about the film, you can go to mdmathemovie.com, click the donate button, or just go to donate.mdmathemovie.com. And we have a crowdfunding campaign up there. Between this one and the previous one, we've got over 1,400 donors. Love the site. It's only a small portion of the money we need to finish the film. We have a lot of, you know, bigger funders and investors too, but I love the fact that so many people have contributed in many ways. It is a crowd-funded documentary by the people, for the people, to help end the drug war. We also released up there our opening title sequence. It's a two-minute long. It'll change a little bit as we add new producers and stuff onto it, but the credit sequence at the beginning of the film, we have footage of Sasha Shulgin's laboratory. Pretty cool, so people should go check it out.
Yeah, you did a great job with some of those effects there. It looked really, really neat, highly polished. Really excited to see how this goes. I think we do need more high-quality films on subjects other than just ayahuasca.
Right. That's why I thought, when I resigned from Dan Safe, I always had in the back of my head, wow, man, this is an incredible experience, and maybe one day I should make a movie about harm reduction and MDMA, really, you know, obviously. Someone's going to do it, right? I always thought someone's going to have to do it. I mean, it's the second most popular drug among millennials or people under 30 today after cannabis. And there have been films on heroin. There have been films on cocaine, cannabis, obviously. Come on. Why isn't anyone making the film on MDMA? So I just realized, well, I got to do it because nobody else is going to do it.
Yep, that's the point in time where you have to make the decision to do things. It's just clear that nobody else is going to take the thing.
Yeah, and I think, let me just end with this. I think MDMA is the drug that's going to end the drug war, and I'll tell you exactly why. Because of the drug war, aside from the corruption, you know, CIA, government officials taking kickbacks, protecting the trade, all that kind of stuff, which we're not going to deal with in the movie. But aside from sort of the money involved in the drug trade, the other main reason the drug war continues is because we internalize the stigma and the judgment that we're told by our culture around drugs. These drugs are just hedonistic pursuits. They're very bad. And if you use a drug, you can pretty much internalize that stigma. You can say, oh, this feels really good. I like this, but I know it's bad, right? But you can't do that with MDMA. MDMA's pharmacological effect is to increase your self-acceptance and compassion for yourself. It brings the best out of someone. You feel good about yourself. You want to apologize to your mother for something you said. You know, it has a therapeutic effect that other drugs don't have, that sort of doesn't allow you to internalize that judgment against you when you're on it. I've been told this by a lot of people, you know, kind of my age who are like in their mid-40s and kind of grew up with the 80s drug war propaganda and, you know, like, oh, you know, drugs are bad, right? You'd never do drugs, right? And then that's mid-80s, that's right when MDMA started coming out. And then you take MDMA and you're like, whoa, wait a minute. How can this be illegal? That's a very common expression people say when they first take MDMA, because you think it's going to like bring out some hedonistic, naughty kind of feeling in you, but instead you feel relaxed and clear-headed, and you want to, like, make friends, and you want to make up with, you know, conflicts with people in your life whom you love, or all these things happen, and you're like, how can this be illegal? And it gets people questioning the propaganda around all drugs, which we need to do. And I think the psychedelic community needs to realize that as well. Too many of us want to say that our drugs are good drugs and we're okay because we only use ayahuasca and LSD, et cetera, but, you know, cocaine and opiates, those are, you know, we still harbor the same judgments against those drugs. But we need to start rethinking that. We all need to get on the same page to end this drug war.
Absolutely. I'm glad you raised that. Thank you for that. I think it's an underrepresented opinion and position that, you know, we can't just talk about our drugs being superior. It's not the way forward. It's not the way for justice and harm reduction. If for harm reduction alone, it's not about, you know, ayahuasca is the best drug on the planet. We have to have a holistic approach here and work together as a team. So thank you.
Well, thank you for what you're doing. Yeah.
Odds are good you've been in a strange situation regarding somebody handing you some drug and you didn't know how to use it. Even if it was, you know, you were 17 years old and somebody handed you a joint, you go, doesn't this make me go crazy? How do you level up your knowledge and get a handle on what drugs are safe, how to do drugs, how to know if this stuff is okay to do? Like, does LSD cause chromosome damage? You know, that big lie from the 60s, 70s. And, you know, it doesn't. So how do you clear these things up? Kyle and I developed a class, Navigating Psychedelics, and it is, consider it a 101, 102 of psychedelics. How to do them, how to be safe, how to make sure you and your friends don't go to prison or go to the hospital. And we walk you through a lot of that process. We do some live support through our secret and closed Facebook group. There's also the ability to communicate inside the course. We are going to start offering regular live check-ins, webinar check-ins to folks, and that can really help support the process. So far, the feedback has been tremendous. People are very excited about the class and are shocked at the amount of value we've thrown in there. We did a whole bunch of master classes with experts in particular sub aspects of psychedelics. The folks who are featured as masterclass teachers, Lenny Gibson, PhD, Elizabeth Gibson, those are both our breathwork teachers, Larry Norris from Erie on integration, Paul Austin on microdosing, Shannon Claire Carlin, she works for MAP, she's great, Catherine McLean, PhD, Ashley Booth, MS, Neil Marshall Goldsmith, PhD, Mitchell Gomez, executive director of Dance Safe, Julie Megler, MSN, so she's a nurse practitioner that also works at Erie with Larry Norris. Dr. Richard Grossman, who's a acupuncturist, he's got a PhD on ayahuasca, light hearts and safety, we call that one. Vilmarie Narlock from the Students for Sensible Drug Policy. Michelle Hobart, MS, Spiritual Emergence and Self-Care. Dr. Ingmar Gorman, clinical psychologist who works closely with Catherine McLean in New York. And yeah, that's it for now, but we're going to keep adding more. I think we're going to get one with Daniel McQueen soon, so keep an eye out for that. And hope you have the opportunity to check it out. If you want to get better educated on psychedelics, this is a great way to start. Even if you've been around for a long time, you might have picked up some, what to call it, hippie wisdom or something that might not necessarily be right, you know, about brown acid or black acid or whatever. Kind of all just one molecule. You can test for that molecule and know that you've got a molecule. Maybe there's some side additives, but this is stuff that we really need to figure out and get straight. We need a baseline of knowledge as a community here, and this is our contribution to that. So you can learn more at psychedelicstoday.com, and if you want to go right to our site, it's psychedelicstoday.teachable.com. If you are interested in doing legal psilocybin mushroom work in Jamaica with an expert, you really want to go check out Eric Osborne. You can find him at mycomeditations.com. Coming up in late November, I think right after Thanksgiving, you can go down to Jamaica, work with him, and do some serious inner work on yourself. Mushrooms do allow really great access to your inner landscape, and doing it on the beach in a beautiful environment in Jamaica is a great spot to do it. I really do recommend Eric Osborne, and you should check out a couple of our past episodes with him if you want to get a feel for him personally. I really do appreciate what he's doing and can't wait to get down there. Coming up, this November retreat will feature Catherine McLean, PhD, and Shane Moss, the comedian. There's also another comedian, don't know the name, but you should check that one out on their site because that could be really special. Catherine's going to bring a lot of information about psychedelic safety and integration practices. Shane is going to talk at length about his healing process and explorations through psychedelics. The last podcast we did with Shane, Eric helped us there. It was really fun because Shane got into a lot of the funny, great parts of psychedelics and also some of the scary parts. You know, having people that have that knowledge available to help guide you through this stuff is great. And Eric's been through, you know, has been doing this for an incredible amount of time, so he's a pro. What's the thing? 20,000 hours? Yeah, whatever that rule is of you put in so many hours of practice to get to this expert level. He's at about master level, so, you know, you're probably going to want to check him out. If you don't want to go do ayahuasca in Peru your first time, maybe you want a shorter flight from the US or Europe and you don't really see the need to go upriver in a little boat, maybe this is for you. Yeah, again, mycomeditations.com, and you can learn a lot more there, mycomeditations.com. If you have any questions about it, you know, feel free to email us, psychedelicstoday@gmail.com. Hope you check it out. If you want to look really cool in some Psychedelics Today gear, you really want to check out psychedelicstodayshop.com. We've got all sorts of cool stuff from t-shirts to mugs to shower curtains and pillows. So you check it out. Any small purchase helps, even if it's just some stickers. We got some cool stickers there. Check it out, psychedelicstodayshop.com. Tell your friends. Maybe buy some presents for this upcoming, what do you guys call it, Black Friday? Yeah, Black Friday. Maybe that. Or maybe it's a Christmas present or whatever. We would love you guys to check out some of our stuff there and support the show. Thanks.